for your mercy, for your grace, oh God. Thank you for your love and kindness. That's so much better than life. God, we thank you that you love us with such a great love. Thank you that you have not rewarded us according to our sins and our iniquity, oh God. But your grace, Lord. And your mercy that are new every morning. Now, Father, thank you for bringing us together in this place at this time. Before the world were ever framed, God, you knew that we would be in this place today. And you have ordained it to be so. Father, we dare not go on and not say thank you for the gift of Pastor and Lady Marvels. We thank you for it, God. Joining us together in this hour. Thank you that you brought together a people and shepherds, oh God. You said you would give us shepherds after your own heart, that they would feed us with knowledge and understanding and wisdom, oh God. And we thank you because you're no shorter than your word. Now, Pastor, we pray today that this place would be filled with unity, with love, with hope, with expectancy, God. We thank you for that, God. We thank you. We thank you that when we leave this place up today, God, we'll be better than when we came through those doors. Not because of any human personality, but because we bear your presence of your Holy and Divine Spirit, oh God. Father, we thank you that when we got Pastor and Mars, we didn't just get them, but we got a mother, we got brothers and cousins and friends, God. You do that, Father. We ask you for A and B, but you gave us C, E, F, and G, God. We thank you for that today. God, we thank you. We thank you, Father. Now, God, you're the only one that's really allowed to sit back in this place today. You sit back and you enjoy the worship. You receive the praise, God. You sit back, Father. And I pray that when we leave here, Lord, you will be satisfied with your people, God. And we give you thanks and honor and glory. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. Thank you.
I'm
T. I'm going to have another TNT ready for you later on. We'll get to that. But we're happy to be here today. We're happy to have this opportunity to be master and mistress of ceremony at such a great occasion. How about the first pastoral anniversary? For your presence. Y'all are looking beautiful today. Give your hands, give yourself a hand clap. Y'all looking great. Y'all looking beautiful. And the spirit is in this place.
Yes, sir.
You know, I was going to talk about the spirit just for a minute.
Come on.
You know, because we all about the spirit. The spirit lives here.
Yes.
In Second Mount Hour. If you don't believe me, who was here Wednesday night? Well, the Bible says let everybody have breath. Praise the Lord. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. We're going to praise the Lord today. That's what we come for. We came to praise the Lord, give him worship, and to celebrate our brother and sister, our pastor and leader. And it's like Jeremiah said, it's like fire. Shut up in my bones. It's so much that I can't contain. It's so much that I can't keep it all in. It's so much that I just can't keep my mouth shut. When I say, fired up,
yes.
Y'all say ready to go.
Okay.
Fired up. Thank you for your presence.
Amen.
And let me start off by thanking us for the gifts.
Amen.
The gifts. My pastor, just a few words. I love you.
Amen.
Yeah. This man of God.
Amen.
He loves God.
Yes.
He loves this church.
Yes.
He loves us members.
Yes.
All right.
He loves people.
Yeah.
He loves serving.
Yeah.
He loves preaching.
All right.
He loves teaching.
Yeah.
And God knows he loves praying.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. And so Pastor Toy and I are here to celebrate you today, you and dear Sister Morris, and to give you all that we have to give.
Yeah.
You know, and we pray that God's grace, his kindness and his mercy, that his light, keep his light shine upon you for the rest of your days.
Amen.
And God, that the Spirit carries you through in your journey here at Second Mount Hour.
Amen.
Thank you.
I totally agree with you, Minister, but I have a few words to say about my first lady.
Right.
She is that God-fearing woman that will pray for you from sunrise to sunset.
Sure. Amen.
All right.
She is generous and benevolent.
Yes.
She is R to the E to the A to the L. She is that woman whose faith is unshakable.
Yes.
All right.
And she's a kingdom builder.
Yes.
Who promotes and believes we're better together.
Okay, since we're ready and y'all are ready, let's get started.
All right.
first on the program. We're going to have a welcome and occasion by Sister Carla Samuel and Sister Tony Mingo. Amen. Following that will be a praise selection by our SMO choir.
Amen.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Thank you, God, for your grace and mercy, for you have brought us through. We are living in this moment because of you. We want to thank you and praise you too. Because of your grace and mercy, you have brought us through. To our pastor, Pastor Morris, First Lady Morris, First Family, Pastor Murray, ministers, deacons, and you, my brothers and sisters in Christ. Welcome to our church, Second Mount Olive Baptist Church. Welcome to our church, where God's promise and God's people are made one. As Pastor Morris teaches us, we are better together. Welcome to our church, where God is our shepherd and we shall not want. Welcome to our church, where we are taught that we are servants of a good, good Father, and He is good. Go taste and see that the Lord is good. Welcome to our church, where you can walk in dead and yet come out alive. Welcome to our church, where every time we turn around, God keeps on blessing us. Welcome to our church house, where the dynamic, spirit-filled, powerhouse pastor of the Fellowship of Purpose Church, Pastor Byron Murray, will be bringing a mighty word from God. Welcome to our church house. Whose house?
Our house.
God's house. Welcome to Second Mount Island Baptist Church.
And we also would like to say, for Pastor Morris, Corinthians chapter 12 says, "For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, through many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in one spirit we are baptized into one body. Jews, Greeks, slaves, or free, and all we are made to drink of one spirit. If he has not taught anything else, he has definitely taught Corinthians 12, verses 12 through 21. The end part in 21 says, "The eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need for you. Nor again can the head say to the feet, I have no need for you." For Pastor Morris has taught us we are one family, one body, with many members. We are better together.
Amen.
So for this occasion, I say to Pastor Morris and his First Lady, you have brought us great leadership, and it has been a blessing and an honor this last
year. Amen.
So on this occasion, we briefly say, under the leadership of Pastor Morris and Sister Rita, we have fed the community and the SMO church here for a food drive. We have grown our choir ministry. We have grown our prayer ministry. We have grown our senior ministry. We have grown our men's ministry. We have grown our fabulous women's ministry. We have grown our church membership. We have grown our culinary ministry. We have grown our media ministry. And we have grown our children's ministry. Spreading the gospel abroad, Pastor Morris and Sister Rita have taken us out of the sanctuary, into the community, and back into the sanctuary. I say today, everyone please stand and give a great welcome to our pastor, Morris Bryan, and
been a year since Pastor Morris has been chosen to be the pastor of this church. Today I've been blessed with the task of being able to honor a man who's unselfish and giving in his overall way of life in general. I'm honored to give a tribute to my spiritual leader, who just so happens to be my brother. I'm honored for so many reasons, plus I can tell you private things that you probably don't know about. When I was coming up a long time ago, it was only me and my brother, my younger brother. Of course, we knew who our siblings were, but everyone was split up, and we didn't have much of a relationship outside of us. We were young, so at that point in our lives, we didn't realize how important it was to have a relationship with our other family. I remember one day, out of nowhere, Brian reached out to us saying that he wanted to be in our lives and he wanted us to come for the weekend, which soon led to him picking us up every weekend after. He made it his job to be there for us on every level to make sure that we stayed close. Our relationship and bond with him grew immediately. We would go places and do something fun every weekend. He would make sure that we were in church every weekend as well. We were basically his kids before his kids. Ron had always been straightforward and a tell like it is kind of guy, which you often get to see when he's delivering the word. He delivers powerful message after powerful message every Sunday. His devotion to his craft and soul saving sets him apart from most pastors. He's a great father and provider to his family at all costs, and his leadership and guidance speak volumes. I've always admired how his personality stays the same inside and outside the church. He's honest in his word, and he stays true to his beliefs. He loves sports and being around family. He's a serious competitor in, at anything he does. Although I never judged him for being a Lakers fan. For some reason, he seemed to think that Kobe was always better than Michael Jordan.
Absolutely.
I've always admired his confidence, his strength in words, and his non-judgmental approach. I sometimes turn to him for a sample of approval because I know he's going to give it to me straight. So to my brother, you're my pastor, you're my brother and my mentor. I look up to you more than you know for many reasons. Your love and positivity goes unmatched in my eyes. The way God uses you is almost unfair, but you definitely earned it. The church has had you for a year, but I've been blessed to have you throughout my life. I love you, and I'm proud to call you pastor.
I'm not Jeremy, but good afternoon, Second Mama. I'm very pleased and honored to stand before you today on this very first anniversary of our pastor and first lady. And I'm so excited to be a part of this momentous occasion. As you probably know, I could stand here and brag and boast about my son and our pastor to no end, but I won't. I will just tell you a few hard facts about your pastor that I know to be true. Brian was born March the 5th, 1975 at 4:21 p.m. And after 16 hours of no pain, no labor, no nothing, just 16 hours. And then here comes the most handsome, amazing, coming. Oh, okay. My baby's starting to break. But the fact was, I had never felt love by anyone or anything that could compare to the love I felt for this special gift that God had chosen to trust me with. The way that Brian showed care for his toys, his siblings, even his mother was so touching. As he began to grow, the compassion that he exhibited to others was very noticeable to myself and others. He also showed great pride in responsibility that he had for his younger brothers and sisters. And just the great compassion they had for other people was what I could only call amazing. When Brian was a small child, he had this one thing that I found very odd about him. He just could not lie. If he did it, he said he did it. If he broke it, he said he broke it. Well, I thought it was good. And as a mother, out of all the books that I had read, not one had said anything about this. Tell me what to do on such occasions. Brown was so honest, sometimes I just didn't know what to do. So now I have a very helpful, caring, and responsible son.
Yeah.
And we can now add honest to that list.
Amen.
We have in Brian a great person, father, friend, husband, and son. And as I stand here before my pastor and my first lady and the congregation, it's only by the grace of God I say proudly to my son, my pastor, and the head of this church, I love you, son. And I will love you until I take my very last breath. Believe that. And I just want to say congratulations, and may God continue to bless you to be the man of God that you are. Continue to preach, teach, and grow this church.
Yeah.
I know that you will go far and be successful in everything that you do. And in my heart, I know that God is pleased with you. Pleased with you and your dedication that you have to this church.
Yes.
And you will go far because we are better together.
Amen.
And as I close, I just want you to know, as your mother, I am pleased, as a member of Second Mount Olive, I am pleased. Continue to be the great man of God that you are. Congratulations. I love you, Pastor and First Lady.
Amen.
Great is the Lord, my God. Yes.
Now, when I was assigned this to speak on First Lady,
yes,
everything came through my mind.
Come on.
All right.
Because in 1 year, she has made a great impact.
All right.
I refer to 1 Corinthians chapter 11 through 12. And the scripture says, nevertheless, neither is the man without the woman, neither the woman without the man in the Lord. For as the woman is of the man, even so is the man also the woman. But all things of God. It is a holy blessing to be born with the exquisite qualities of a daughter of God.
Come on.
I think about my first wife.
Come on.
I think about she has the spirit of discernment over her life.
Come on.
When I'm in trouble, I call her and immediately she prayed. She seeks God first.
Yes.
She loves unconditionally.
Yes.
She's obedient.
Yes.
She keeps her family first.
Yes.
She's a faithful servant.
Yes.
And she stands on kingdom business. Because she operated in the spirit.
Yes.
The oil is burning deep.
Yes.
And it shows daily.
Yes.
Not only
come on,
do she represent in the house, but she represents outside of the house. Loves to bestow hope.
Yeah.
A straight missionary that comes in and preach the word of God.
Yes.
Come on. So to my first lady.
Yes.
Peace and real.
Yes.
Yeah.
a church folk. Is he here?
Yes.
Is the presence of the Lord?
Yes.
Is he here?
Yes.
There's nothing like being in the presence of the Lord. To God be the glory for the great things he has done. We just thank God for this day, a day to celebrate what God is doing through this man and this woman. I told somebody that time flies when you're having fun. It's been a year already. Let's do some house cleaning real quick. House cleaning real quick. Can we thank God and thank Sister Judy for these beautiful programs?
Yeah.
Aren't these awesome?
Yeah.
Wow. Got a little bookmark in the back just to take home with you. Got a gift in there for me. And then thank God for our master and mistress of ceremony.
Yeah.
Occasion, Sister Carla Samuels and Sister Tony Mingo, thank you for your welcome and occasion. And thank the best choir this side of the Mississippi.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Master Powell and this choir. And then this tribute by his brother and his mother.
Yeah.
Wow. You did an awesome job. Brian O. Morris. Y'all know what O stand for? I'm not going to tell you. I know.
Outstanding.
Outstanding.
All right.
And that's just Sister Shaquilla.
Yeah.
Sister Shaquilla Harper.
Amen.
Take up the offering after she get done. Telling you. And then these dancers,
right?
Thank God for these dancers. Now, we're up to the offering, and just a disclaimer. I am not Donald Taylor. God made one Donald Taylor. And that, Donald Ray. And after he made Donald Ray, he broke the mold. But listen, first let me thank Pastor Hall from the Kingdom Builders Cathedral. He's in our presence today. We want to thank God for him. Thank God for him. You know the ministers, the clergy, and the audience? Would you stand? You know the ministers, the clergy, and the audience? Would you stand so we can recognize you? Thank you, my brother. Thank you, my sister. Thank you, my brother. You know Pastor Hanks is sitting over there as well. Thank you, Pastor Hanks, for coming this evening.
It's an honor to be back. I was here last year, and I really, really enjoyed myself, and I didn't know that I would be back this year, but I'm happy that I am. We serve an awesome God, amen. And don't you just feel the love? You know, I love coming to a church where when you walk in, the people make you feel welcome. Nobody's all snooty acting, and they just want you to come in the house and be in the house and do what you do in the house, and you have the freedom to just be free. I love that about y'all. They're like my, I'm a little older than they are, so they're like my little brother and little sister, but I have grown to really love you all. I became friends with them through my sister and her husband, who are pastors as well. But I love you all. I really do. I feel the love here in your church. I feel the love that you have for each other. And I feel the love that all of us have for Jesus. And that's enough for me. Amen. I love the Lord. I love him with all of my heart. And I have dedicated my life to him in every way. And I do mean in every way. I am his. And so every time I get an opportunity to stand and proclaim God's word in song, I'm elated. I want to share a secret with you right quick. I know I don't look like it, but God has allowed me. And I just started doing this year. Because everybody says you need to share your secret. So the Lord has allowed me on this earth for 65 years. I want you to know that you are looking at a 65-year-old saint. and I say that because I know I don't look 65. God has been good to me. And so I want you to know that when you give your life to him, he will preserve you. I'm a witness. I really am a witness. You know, I've gone through a lot in my life, a lot, that should have really taken me out of here. And I mean straight out of here. And I asked the Lord, I said, Lord, I don't want to look like what I've been through. I don't want to look broke down. I want to look good when I stand to honor you and to give you glory. And do you not know that you're looking at a testimony? Because God has kept me. And he has restored the years that the enemy thought he was going to take. But the devil is a lie. And as long as I have breath in my body, I'm going to stand and tell of the goodness of God. Tell me who can make a mountain move out of my way, and who can make a miracle just because of my faith? And when the doctor says no, who can still God is able. and healed fail. Who can make a river out of a little stream? Who can make the clouds roll back so the sun can look at little me? Who can make the wind whistle through the trees? And when I find you, I find myself in trouble. Who is there to see about me?
Thank you.
church to me. Came to have church. Not church. Church. Thank you, Lord. The man's all right with me. The man's all right with me. Can we thank God for the gift to the body of Sister Beatty? Sister Beatty Jones, can we thank God for the gift to the body? Sister Beatty. Hope I look half that good. I'm 65. God, he's a preserver. Listen, we've had praying, we've had praising. It's preaching time. And I'm anxious to hear from this man. But I'm not going to prolong time. Would you stand to your feet? Stand to your feet. Your loudest voice. Your loudest voice. Your loudest voice. Repeat after me. Pastor Murray. Pastor Byron Murray. You are welcome in this place. Preach. 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 Say amen as he comes.
Bless the Lord. This is the day that the Lord has made. We ought to be still rejoicing and being glad about it. Anybody love Jesus in this place today? Oh, come on, come on. You had to ask if you love me. I said, does anybody love Jesus in this place? What a time we've already had in this place. And we certainly want to give God praise for every person that has taken this platform. We praise God for our mistress and master of ceremony, and for all that you guys have spoken and the way you've led us throughout all of this. We praise God for everyone who has sang today. Come on, can we give God praise to him, set the atmosphere? And I certainly want to give God praise for the love that you all have extended to this man and to this woman of God. Can we all celebrate Pastor Morris and Lady Rita Morris today? I want to say to the Second Mount Olive Missionary Baptist Church, I'm telling you, the Lord has great plans for this church. Do y'all believe that? Come on, celebrate the Lord. The Lord has plans for this house. I want to speak to that end today. Some of the members came from the FOP church because they have such love and such great support for this man and woman of God. And so we wanted to be here to say God bless you and we love you. FOP, just raise your hand. Let them know y'all here with them to say we love you. God bless you. Praise the Lord for you. Praise the Lord for you. Dr. Hank, so good to see you. Praise the Lord for you. Man of God, and my mother and father are here. They all to my left. Come on, y'all raise your hand. I want everybody to see my parents. And y'all have to pray for me that I stay focused because I got my eyes on this pretty lady that's about a few rows back. And I need y'all to pray for me so I can stay focused to preach this word today. I brought with me the first lady of the FOP church. So you guys you got it set up. So let's get right on into the word of the Lord today. Take your Bibles, open them to the book of Nehemiah, chapter number 6. And I want to get right on into what the Lord sent me over here to say. I don't believe I'll be before you long. I believe you guys have said so much. I've seen so much happen in the spirit. I believe there are some things that are breaking through in the spirit realm. And I just kind of want to speak to it for a few minutes before you. Nehemiah chapter number 6. I'm going to look at verse 1 through verse number 3. And I just want to set in context, I believe, what God wants you to do as we. God wants to leave some instructions for this house. Nehemiah chapter number 6, verse number 1 through 3, the Bible says, "Now when it was reported to Sanballat, Tobiah, and to Geshem the Arab, and to the rest of our enemies, that I had rebuilt the wall, and that no breach remained in it, although at that time I had not set up the doors and the gates. Then Sanballat and Geshem sent a message to me saying, come let us meet together at Shapiram in the plain of Ono. But they were planning to harm me. So I sent messengers to them saying this, that I am doing a great work and I cannot come down. Why should the work stop while I leave it and come down to you? I want y'all to help me put a tag on this text. Look at somebody to your left or to your right and just tell them, I'm building something. I'm building something. Can we pray together? Spirit of the living God, how we worship and we honor your presence today. We give your name the glory and the honor. Truly, you are worthy of all of the praise. We thank you, Lord God, for your presence in this house. We thank you, God, that because of this anointing, every yoke will be destroyed. Every burden will be removed. God, open the eyes of your people. Speak your word, God. And I pray that as your word goes forth today, strongholds will come down in the name of Jesus. Satan is defeated and the blood is against him. And there is victory in the people of God. Lord, we thank you that you're building up a house. You're building up a movement to do great things in the community and in the kingdom of God. So right now, by faith, we give you praise, glory, and honor, because great things are about to happen today, and great things are going to happen through this church. We call it done. In the mighty and the matchless name of Christ, our King, we pray. Somebody who loves him ought to shout hallelujah in the place today. And on your way down, look at somebody again. Tell them, I'm building something. I'm building something. Praise the name of the Lord. For the Lord is my shepherd, and I shall not want. For he maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me, for thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. When you look at Psalms 23, it reminds us all of the great love and the great care of the shepherd. I need you to understand that the shepherd does feed the flock, and the shepherd does lead the flock, and the shepherd does protect the flock. But don't miss this, the shepherd also has plans for the flock. One of the things you need to understand that this psalm is written from the perspective of the Eastern shepherds. And David, as he writes this, understands full well what it meant to take care of sheep. And the reason why you would take care of sheep. You gotta understand that these sheep are not pets, but they are productive. These sheep produce, and the wool comes out of them, and the milk comes forth, and the lamb's meat, and the cheese, and all of it, it comes out of the sheep. So don't divorce the fact that the reason why the shepherd is so good to the sheep is because the shepherd got work for the sheep to do. It's something that the sheep has to be able to produce, to be able to fulfill their purpose in the earth. You see, the shepherd does feed the flock. The shepherd leads the flock. The shepherd protects the flock. The shepherd has plans for the flock. And too often I believe that we get twisted and confused what the role of the shepherd is and why the shepherd is really here. As a matter of fact, the Bible says in Ephesians chapter number 4, verse number 11, that God gave some to be apostles, and then he gave some to be prophets, and he gave some to be evangelists, and some to be pastors and teachers. Watch this. Here's the purpose: for the equipping of the saints for the work of service. One more time. The pastor's role is to equip the saints for the work of service, which means the reason why you need a pastor is because you got some work to do. Is there anybody in here at the Second Mile Island Baptist Church that's saying, put me in the game, I'm ready to work, I'm ready to serve and do what it is that God has led me to do? The shepherd is a leader. The shepherd is a feeder. The shepherd is a protector. But here it is, Pastor. The shepherd must be a visionary. The shepherd has to see. As a matter of fact, who in the world wants to be led by a shepherd that can't see nothing? Who wants to be led by a shepherd that has nothing that he's looking forward to see down the line? As a matter of fact, the shepherd needs to be able to see the challenges in the house. The shepherd has to see the devils that are being stirred up. The shepherd has to see the problems in the community. The shepherd has to see the solutions that God has prepared. Look at somebody and say, I need my pastor to see. Come on. I need my pastor to be able to see. That's one of the things that I was assigned to come here to do, to remind you of how important it is to lift up the arms of your pastor, to lift him up, to pray for him, to lift up the arms of the woman of God so they can be in the position that God really placed them to be in. I know they are humble people, and I know there's nothing that they don't mind doing, but here's the question: where is their energy best served? I'm trying to get you to understand that if they got to answer every call, if they got to go see every sick person, if they got to be the ones come here all the time to take care of everything, when are they ever going to be in the presence of the Lord? That's why God sent them here in the first place. As a matter of fact, I'll never forget, Pastor, I was at a conference years ago, and this young man was telling us how we needed to grow and how we needed to structure our church. And he was trying to help me understand, Pastor, whatever you do, make sure you're not doing too much. And so he was speaking this, and he says, can I give you an illustration? He said, Pastor, if I'm on a flight and we are 40,000 feet in the air, and we get an indicator on the dashboard that says we got some problem in the engine room. He says, I don't care how good of a mechanic my pastor is. I don't care how much he knows about engines. Can you imagine the pastor heading down to the engine room? There he is tinkering with his tools. He got his wrench out. He got his socket out. He's moving, and he's doing what needs to be done. But all of a sudden, somebody ought to be asking the question, if the pastor is in the engine room, who is flying the plane? I need to be able to lift up my pastor, to lift up his arm so I can make sure he's flying the plane. I need him in the face of the Father. I need him hearing the voice of God so he can lead me where I need to be. Do I have a witness in here today of somebody that said, I'm going to come to support my pastor to make sure he is doing what God really told him to do? And so this pastor and this leader that the Lord has sent here, y'all got to make sure that y'all keep them in the right position. The pastor is a leader. The pastor is a feeder. The pastor is a visionary. And I know some of you are having a hard time grasping this word. And let me tell you why. It's because the only sheep that need to be led are the ones that's going somewhere. I'm gonna mess with you a minute, but you're looking. The reason why sheep fight sometimes is because they are the ones that ain't going nowhere. I wish I had somebody here right now to say, Pastor, lead me because I'm going somewhere. Am I preaching to anybody in the building right now? They say, Pastor, look, I'm going somewhere. I'm going high in my faith. I'm going further in my finances. I'm going deeper in the Word of God. I'm going further in my knowledge. As a matter of fact, Second Mount Island, y'all are going somewhere. Y'all going to feed the hungry. Y'all going to clothe the naked. Y'all going to loose the captive. Y'all going to heal the sick. Y'all going to win the lost. And y'all going to bring the backslider back. Am I preaching to anybody in the building that say, I need a pastor because I'm going somewhere? I'm trying to get to this text because I was sent here to remind you that you got to lift up the arms of the man and woman of God. You have to support the vision of the house because they are leading you. And if you are going somewhere, you want them to always remain in the right position. And so this book in Nehemiah here is one about a man who is rebuilding some walls. He's working and he's building. Come on, tell somebody, I'm building something. I'm building something. He's working and he's building something. Nehemiah chapter 1, y'all track with me. I promise you, I won't be before you long. I'm halfway done already. Nehemiah chapter number 1, verse number 3, the Bible says, they said to me that the remnant there in the province who survived the captivity, I'm in verse 3, are in great distress. They are in reproach, and the wall of Jerusalem is broken down, and its gates have been burned with fire. Jerusalem is in a bad situation. Nehemiah is the cupbearer, and he lives in a place called Susa. He's a long way from the capital there in Jerusalem. He has this cush job, and there he is. He's living, y'all. I mean, he moved out of Cashmere Gardens. He's out of Cynicwood. He's out of Lakewood. He's not in Fifth Ward no more. The boy's out in Kingwood, and he got it going on there, out there in Kingwood. And so he stops at Deerbrook Mall, and while he's at Deerbrook Mall, come his boys from Fifth Ward show up to Deerbrook Mall. He asks the question, how they doing in the hood of Cavalcade? What's happening on Lockwood and Rand and Lavender? What's going on over there? Can I get the report of what's happening in the hood? And so he gets this word. He said, it's not going good down there. He said, can you tell me what's going on? He said, they kick it in houses right now. He says, young people are being locked up over and over in a cycle of incarceration. He says, human trafficking is even hitting the area right there close to the church. He said, there are homeless people that live right there in walking distance from our own church. He says, right there, there's all types of things happening, prostitution and all types of stabbings and killings. He said, it's not doing good right there. And all of a sudden, Nehemiah hears the word. He said, just because I got it going on where I live, I need to have a heart for the broken and a heart for the hurting, and I got to have a heart to do something about the people that are struggling in the neighborhood. And right there, God gives Nehemiah his heart. And number one, I'm going to teach you today four things you need to pray for your pastor. And number one, write this down. Pray that your pastor has the heart of God. Pray that the things that breaks God's heart will break your leader's heart. Pray that the things that are on God's mind are on your leader's mind. Because if the things that are on God's mind are not on your leader's mind, then y'all will just come here every Sunday and shout and run and clap, and your neighborhood will still go to hell. What good is it for you to come in here having a hallelujah good time when the gates are down and the walls are burned and people are going to hell and don't know who Jesus Christ is? You ought to pray. You got a shepherd that has the heart of God that wants to do something about the pain that people are going through. The first thing y'all pray for your pastor. The number one, that your pastor will have the heart of God. Bible says in Matthew 16:18, he says, I say unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. It is what the church is supposed to be like, Pastor. And I know right now you're building something. And we're not talking about brick. We're not talking about mortar. We're not talking about wood. We're talking about building an organization, building a vehicle that will get outside the doors of the church and make a difference, building a people that want to influence others and impact their neighborhood. I need to know, who am I talking to today? Where are the members of the Second Mount Island Baptist Church? Just raise your hand up and let me know that you're ready to be, to embrace the vision of the man and woman of God, ready to make a difference in the neighborhood that God sent you to be in. And so here it is. Here it is. The pastor has to have his people pray. And the first thing that you guys have to pray for your man of God and for your woman of God is simply this, that they will be in tune with the heart of God. But the second thing, you're going to see it in Nehemiah chapter number 1, verse number 6. Look at it in your Bibles. The Bible says, let your ear now be attentive and your eyes be open to hear the prayer of your servant, which I am praying before you night and day. And Nehemiah, for the next several verses, takes off in powerful believing prayer. And the next thing you ought to pray for your man of God and your woman of God every day, that they will be great people of prayer. I should have got a better amen than that right there. Maybe it's because you don't realize that everything opens and shuts because of prayer. Maybe you don't realize that with prayer that the prison doors will be opened up and chains will be broken and shackles will be loosed. Maybe y'all don't really understand the power of prayer, that in prayer the sick will be healed and there'll be divine reversals happening. Those that were on drugs will get free in the name of Jesus. Maybe y'all don't understand that prayer can still do something. Get a prayer for you. And so we're going to be praying for our man of God and praying for our woman of God that they will be people of great prayer. As a matter of fact, I believe that you can measure the effectiveness of a church by its prayer meeting. If we have a potluck, everybody showing up. We got free barbecue, everybody showing up. We're giving away free food. You said crawfish too? Oh, yeah, they sure coming for the crawfish. They're coming for all of that. But how many of you get excited just because pastor says we're going to have a prayer meeting? Because a prayer meeting is the best meeting. And a prayer meeting can turn the church. A prayer meeting can shift marriages. And a prayer meeting can shift the community. Come on. There's nothing that cannot happen when the body of Christ comes together to pray. To be in tune with the heart of God. I want my man and woman of God to be people of great prayer. I want that. I'm going to pray that for them every day. But then number three, I want my man of God to know where God is taking me. I'm right here in the text. I'm in Nehemiah chapter number 2. Track with me now. Nehemiah chapter number 2. And you can get over to verse number 4. I invite you in your quiet moments to read all of this. It'll really bless your life. But I just want to pull out some key verses to set context to what the Lord sent me here to say. Nehemiah chapter number 2, verse number 5. Then the king said to me, what would you request? I love this. And so Nehemiah, the Bible said, so I prayed to the God of heaven. Don't miss it, y'all. Here he is, and he got a door open for the Lord. And the king says to him, Nehemiah, you can have whatever it is that you want. What is it that you want me to do? And in this moment, God is about to give Nehemiah the burden of confirmation to help him understand what his assignment is in the earth. Listen to me. You need a pastor that hears God clearly concerning what this church is supposed to be about. The problem with most churches today is everybody is just copying the vision over the next person. This church wants to be like that church, and they growing over there, so we want to sing like them. And we got a logo that looks like their logo. They got a lot of folk going. Maybe it's the logo. And so here we are. We got competing logos and competing mission statements and competing vision statements. And God is saying, with all that competition y'all got on, which one of y'all are reaching the lost? Which one of y'all are reclaiming backsliders? Which one of y'all are doing what I sent y'all here to do? And this man of God did not come here to do what you think he ought to do. He did not come here to take the church where you think he ought to take the church. He did not come here to do what was done before he got here. That ain't got nothing to do with him. His job is to take you where God is taking you right now and hear the word of, y'all better help me preach this thing. You need a pastor that hears clearly from God and takes you where God is trying to take you. Rough in here right now. Lord, come on, sit me here and preach it today. He got to know what it is that God sent him here to do. He is not here just to be your hiree. Hear me today. The Bible said in Jeremiah chapter number 3:15 that God sends pastors after his heart. So if God sent him, you can't control him. And if you can't get with the vision, if I were you, I wouldn't fight the vision. Because if you fight the vision, you might be fighting against God. And my pastor used to say it like this, your arm's too short to box with God. Knows exactly where the Lord is leading. Woo, Lord, I feel like we need a song or something. Nehemiah chapter number 4. Come on, let's go. Nehemiah chapter number 4, verse number 1. I'm just walking through this text a little bit. It's what the Lord gave me. Nehemiah chapter number 4, verse number 1. The Bible says, now it came about And when Sanballat heard they were rebuilding the wall, he became furious and angry and mocked the Jews. Y'all, let me tell you something. Haters didn't just show up. Jews doing? They gonna restore it for themselves, and can they offer sacrifice? They ain't gonna finish in a day. Look at verse, look at the haters in verse 3. Now Tobiah the Ammonite was near him, talking about even if they build a building, if they put a fox jump on it, it's gonna break down their stone wall down. Here is prayer number 4. You pray for your pastor every day. Pray this, that my pastor, my first lady, will be encouraged in the face of opposition. That no matter what is fighting them, and no matter who is fighting them, and no matter what is coming up against them, that they will be encouraged in the face of opposition. Because pastor, whenever you start building, you will also be battling. There is no way you can build without a battle, because the battle comes with the building. Whenever you start building something, it's gonna be something to come and your first lady, hear me today, will be encouraged in the face of opposition. Because opposition will mess you up. It'll come from places and people that you didn't think it would come from. I need to help you with this. I got to read this to you. In chapter number 6, I'm almost done, y'all, for real. I'm almost done. Chapter number 6, verse number 2. Sanballat and Geshem sent a message to me saying, come let us meet at Shapiram in the plain of Oh No. And I told them, Oh No. And but they were planning, watch it, don't miss this, to harm me. Don't miss it. So the pastor has to discern every demonic distraction. Pray for your pastor and your first lady that they will discern and sanctified could be used by the devil. But if that's the case, you haven't read your Bible enough, because that was one who Jesus taught. That was one who Jesus fed. That was one who Jesus read and walked with. He was around him all the time. And when Jesus said, I am getting ready to go to the cross, the same one who he was going to raise up to preach the word later on said, far be it, you will not do this. This is not going to happen. I'm not going should have told your pastor on the back if he wanted me to tell you the truth. Boy. I just said yes. Don't be looking at me like that. He says, meet us in Ono. Ono is 20 miles outside of the city gate. Which means, Pastor, if Nehemiah travels to Ono, he'll be 20 miles out of position. And if he's out of position, then who's gonna oversee the project? Who's gonna make sure that what's supposed to be done is gonna get done? And so the plot of the devil is to always try to get us out of position. He'll try to get us out of position mentally. He'll try to get us out of position spiritually. He'll try to get us out of position emotionally. He'll do whatever he got to do. He'll use gossip. He'll use rumors. He'll use drama. That we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against rulers of the darkness in this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. And what the enemy loves is for us to fight people when we don't recognize we're really fighting against him. We got to realize who the devil is using, what the devil is sending through them, and rebuke it in the name of Jesus. And let me tell you, when you rebuke it, it got to flee in the name. They won't spend time upset about it. They won't even be giving it their energy. They won't even be focusing on that, because what God has started cannot be stopped by man anyway. Because if God is in it, if God is for it, it will come to pass. I got to get out of here, y'all. I told y'all I want to just be a little while for you today. But it interests me. I got to sit on down. But it interests me that with all of this rebuilding that was taking place, they putting the gates up. They putting the walls up. They put the walls up, the gates up first now, because the walls represent protection. Well, watch this, but the gates represent access. They had to make sure when they rebuilt Jerusalem that the right access will come into the city. So they put the gates up. Pastor, chapter number 3, they put up 10 gates. They put up the fish gate. And then they put up the old gate, and they put up the valley gate, they put up the fountain gate, put up the water gate, y'all, put up the horse gate, the east gate, even the inspection gate. But they got this one gate that interests me more than any other gate. It was the first gate that they put up. They mentioned it at the beginning of chapter 3, mentioned it at the end of chapter 3. This gate was put up by the priests and the Levites themselves. This gate was the only gate that was consecrated. This gate was called the sheep gate. Now, every gate has its own purpose, but the sheep gate has a unique purpose, because the sheep gate is where the sacrifices come in. It was there that the sacrifices would come in, and the people of Jerusalem understood that, that even on their best day, that their righteousness is like a filthy rag in the sight of God. So therefore, they need something to atone for their sin. So through the sheep gate, they start bringing in all of these animals and all of these bulls and all of these goats and all of these animals, and they would slay them and kill them so that the nation could be forgiven. But they had no idea that what was happening at the sheep gate was no more than a preview of a coming attraction. Because 2,000 years later, after that, there was going to be a lamb that was going to come back to Jerusalem. And when he gets back to Jerusalem, guess what he does? He comes through the sheep gate. And this lamb was going to be slain. And when he is slain, he'll be slain once and for all. Nehemiah has no idea that when he says yes to the building project, that he is doing something that's going to affect his people for generations to come. You have no idea what you're doing now is going to affect future generations to come. So here they are at the the sheep gates, and the animals are coming in one by one. And when they come in, they're sacrificed. And another come in, they're sacrificed. And so when you walk into the sheep gate, all you see, Pastor, is a bloody trail. You just see blood all over the place. And then I started looking, and then I started shouting, and then I started giving God praise, because I remembered that if it had not been for the blood of Jesus, then I wouldn't be saved right now. Is there anybody in here that grew up in church that can testify? What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. And what can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. If my grandma was in here, she said there is a fountain filled with blood that's drawn from Emmanuel's vein, where sinners can plunge beneath the flood and lose all of their guilt and their stain. Oh, I wish y'all really, really grew up in church. Y'all would shout with me, because it reaches to the highest mountain and it flows to the lowest valley. Somebody say the blood will never, ever, ever lose its power. Somebody ought to give God praise for the blood of Jesus. Oh, come on, you can do better than that. Have you been saved? Have you been sanctified? Come on, the Lord brought you out of sin. You ought to give God praise and say, Lord, I thank you for the blood. I thank you the blood heals me. The blood cleanses me. The blood washes me. The blood has opened up the way to give me access. Come on, give him praise for the blood of Jesus. Oh. Okay. We're ready to go. Let me set it in context for you. Pastor is building something. And what he's building will give access for people to get to the blood of the Lamb. What he is building is something that will give access to people who need to be saved, to people who need to come back to God. We don't have time to be focused on anything that ain't about that. We don't have time to not be on one accord when the Lord is trying to save the lives of people, when the Lord is trying to heal, when the Lord is trying to deliver people, when the Lord is setting the captive free. We got to come together on one accord, work and serve God so that the Lord can get the glory. Pastor, I got to do something. I want to be obedient to the Lord. And I want to pray a prayer over the members of the Second Mount Olive Missionary Baptist Church, because they understand that they're going to have to stand in the gap for their man and woman of God. That they got to lift up their arms, pray for them, encourage them. So this is what I want you to do, Pastor, if you don't mind, and you're a lady reading, I want y'all to come. Come just face this way. And then I want just the members, workers, servants, members, Second Mount Olive Missionary Baptist Church, I want y'all to come. And I want y'all to come and flank the man and woman of God. The woman of God that there, put your hands on the shoulders of the woman of God. The woman of God, put your hands on the shoulders of the man of God. Let them feel your love. Second Mount Olive. When the church unites together under a common vision, there is nothing that cannot come to pass. I'm telling you, God's going to do something great with this church, in this community, in this city. It takes unity. It takes support. It takes the body being the body. Lifting each other up, strengthening each other, being there. The pastor been saying it for a long time. Has he not? We better together. Come on, y'all. Oh my God, this is a beautiful sight. These are the people of God that the Lord has sent to embrace the leadership of this man and woman of God. And I believe God's going to use them mightily. Oh God, not just for you. For the sake of the man and woman of God, but for the sake of this entire community. Y'all live here, some of you close here, you know there's some brokenness and some hurt and some pain. There's some folk that need to be delivered, and there's some people that need to change. There's some people that need to come out of bondage, out of darkness, into the marvelous light. And God wants to use his church to bring change in the earth. Y'all, we tell them out for just having church, y'all.
What you say?
Tell them out for just having a good time on Sundays. They don't mean nothing. People are homeless and hurting. In bonds, it means nothing. As a matter of fact, it's an indictment on the church. If the Lord can snatch your church out of its locale, and the community don't miss your presence, it means you ain't doing nothing while you're here. If the Lord pulls your church out of this neighborhood, ought to be a deficit in this area. People ought to come and say, well, where's that church? I got hope there. I got healed over there. Come on, I got delivered in that place. Now, they prayed for me in that place. They were feeding people in that place. Where is that church that touched my life? Father, we bless you and we thank you for this day in the kingdom of God. God, we come to lift up this man and this woman of God. Lord God, that you would encourage their hearts on this day. Lord God, we pray, Lord, that you would give them strength, my God, like they never had before. We pray today in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Lord God, that you would begin to order their steps. We pray that you would speak to them. We pray that you would encourage them. Whenever they get weak and weary on this journey, we pray that the joy of the Lord shall be their strength. Lord, I lift up the members of this house, these great men and women of God that they have called to come alongside this vision. Lord, I pray you use these leaders, use these workers, use these servants, use these laborers in the vineyard. And I pray that not only will they encourage the men and women of God, but Lord, I'm asking you to bless their lives as well. As they serve in the kingdom of God, I pray for them that every need they have will be met. Lord God, as they walk and serve and give honor, Lord, I pray that you would open doors for them. I pray for every member today that you would open doors for them, that you would bless them, that their finances will be blessed, that their marriages will be blessed, that their children will be blessed. Lord, I call the members to head and not to tail, Father. Do a great thing in the lives of the people of God at this church. And then I pray that they shall unify for your glory. And as they come together on one accord, cause this neighborhood to be made better and different. Lord, let this place be a beacon of hope in this community in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Do a great work in these last days, Father. And Father, we're going to stand and look and give you praise and glory and honor. I'm asking that you do exceedingly and abundantly above all we could ever ask or imagine according to the power that's at work in us. Oh, and above all, I pray that there shall be glory in this church. We ask it all in the mighty and the matchless name of Christ, our King. We pray. Those that's ready to serve God, can you shout amen and give God some praise right there? Second on out of the best is yet to come. Second on out of the best is yet to come. Come on. Love on each other. Love on the man and the woman of God. On your way back to your seats, God is about to do a new thing in this place.
I got one word to say. Be great people of prayer. know where God is taking me. Encouraged in the face of opposition. That's a good one. Discern every demonic distraction. Wow. We would be remiss if we not open the doors of the church right now. It's not about church membership. It's about relationship. If you have not accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, we'll open up the doors of the church at this time. Give us something, Patrick. The doors of the church are open. Great is the faithfulness. Not about membership.
Great is the faithfulness.
Here's that one.
Morning, morning. New mercies I see.
Yeah.
All I have.
If you don't know Jesus,
yes,
now is your opportunity.
Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness.
Yes, he's faithful.
Great is thy faithfulness, oh God.
Thank you, Bishop. Ours to extend, yours to accept, and to reject.
Hey, I'm excited, and I don't want to get in trouble, and I'm not going to do anything except for come down here and present this gift to Pastor and Lady Reed. And so this is somewhat of an unveiling, Pastor Morris. This is going to be your picture that's going to go on the wall. Although we had a hard time getting the custom frame made, it's pending. And so this is unveiling. Why don't you pull it off for me? And this will go up on the back wall, Pastor number four. And then we'd like to present you with a love offering. It's a money tree. So money do grow on trees, y'all. Money tree. And then we have a special gift for and then we have a special treat for Lady Reed, a beautiful box. But in that box, we have some things that you have been gifted. And there are gift cards to everywhere. Okay? God bless y'all. Thank you.
Now, we're going to bring a pass at this time now. This past year, this man has poured his soul, his heart and soul, into the ministry here at Second Mount Auburn. I told somebody he's preached every Sunday, I think, except 2 weeks that he hasn't preached. And he's preaching like he's lost his mind. God is using him mighty. You say amen for our pastor. We better together. Ryan Morris.
Now, if you would be seated very quickly, I'm going to ask my wife to come. She is my first lady. And for all of the time that she has to sacrifice my presence for this church, I want to honor her. All of the times when I'm absent and she has to carry on the details of the house. I honor her. I honor her for her unyielding support. I honor her because she's a suitable helpmate. I honor her because the women, although I love them, they don't have to call my phone. They have a first lady that prays for them, that cares about them, that sews into them, and that is up late at night praying for the issues that concern him. So the Bible says that those that are worthy of double honor. I honor you for the sacrifices you make for this ministry. Amen. So I'm gonna give this to you first, right?
Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. The scripture is clear that this is the day that the Lord has made. And what a good day it has been. This has been a good first pastoral anniversary, starting even on Wednesday. Yeah. Pastor Benton came and I'm surprised the church is Benton came on Wednesday. I'm surprised the church is still standing. And his message was entitled, "This is not the first time." And what a deposit was made in the house. What a deposit. This year has been a great year. Pastor and I have been afforded the opportunity to make some great connections, build some great relationships. This journey has brought us closer to God. It has truly kept us on our knees, and it has kept us humble. I am grateful to God. There's so much that I want to say, and I tried to make some little notes right here so that I wouldn't forget. I want to thank our pastoral team. We prayed and prayed. I kept bugging Pastor, when are you going to put somebody in place? We need some help. When are you going to put somebody in place? And he kept saying, not yet, not time. And so I had to be obedient. And then he came and he gave the name. So to the leaders of our pastoral team, Deacon and Sister Collins and Reverend Minister David Taylor and Clarissa Taylor are our leaders. And to their team, job well done. Job well done. To my women's ministry leadership team and the women's ministry here at Second Mount Olive, thank you for all that you have done and assisted me with over this year. Oh my God, to Bishop Powell and the choir, y'all signed. My Lord, the way you ushered the Spirit of the Lord in on Wednesday and on today and over this past year, to God be the glory. To everyone that was on the program today, Sister Judy, to God be the glory. To God be the glory. To God be the glory. Second Mount Olive knows Sister Judy's story, and to see her still, as Pastor preached this morning, going forward and not allowing the situation to consume her. This is just excellent work. I can truly see the love that was put into this. To every joint and ligament of this church. I don't want to start calling names because I'll forget. I'll start saying to the ushers and the greeters and this and that. So then I'll miss some ministry and then y'all will be talking about, first they didn't call my name. So I'm going to say to every joint and ligament of this church, thank you for the year that we have shared together. We are blessed and fortunate to have our parents here. Pastor's parents are here. Alvin, well, he's really Deacon Alvin Hargrove. Deacon Alvin, where you in, Deacon? and Sister Karen, and then we heard his biological crybaby mama right here. I don't care what situation it is, she's gonna cry. We love her. And then my dad is here. I'm always honored to still have my dad here. My dad has Parkinson's, but he said, I may have Parkinson's, but I ain't parked. So Pastor Walter Hanks Jr. and his lovely wife, Julian, thank you both for being here, celebrating with us. I have my eldest brother is here. Michael Hanks and his beautiful family are here celebrating with us. And then y'all heard Jerome here. Jerome, Jeremy, and Megan were my first set of kids before I had kids. Ironically, two boys and a girl. So I officially have two boys and a girl. So I have my oldest son, BJ. His name is really Brian, but he doesn't know that. BJ, baby, stand up, son. Stand up, son. That is Brian Jr. Amen. And his lovely companion, Amaya, wave your hand. Brianna, our middle child. Yep, with you. And then, where's Braylon? Oh, Braylon. Okay, you moved. Braylon, stand up. So, Lord have mercy. I don't want to forget anybody. Thank you so, everybody. Thank you, thank you, thank you to our FOP family. Oh, God. I will honor you today for being here. And I hope I'm not forgetting anybody. Am I forgetting anybody, Beth? Okay, I want to just try to say thank you to everybody. This day has Pastor Hall, thank you for being here. Amen. Pastor Hall is he's everybody's pastor. We thank God for him. He's doing a great work in the community. And we praise God for him. And so to my husband. Listen. I was trying to think of what could I say about my husband, my pastor.
Wow, watch it.
and just thinking about this day and what this day means for him, for us. Trying to really figure out how to put it into words. And the only thing I can really come up with is, I'm trying to sing this one verse. I can't sing it like Andrea, but I'm gonna try. I'm trying to see if I can. It just sums up this whole day. To God be the Lord. I know you saw that. Listen, and this is, you know, no disrespect to Sister Julian, because my dad did what he was supposed to do. But when my mother was living, I watched how my dad took care of my mom, watched how he nurtured her, how he cared for her. And growing up, my whole prayer was, Lord, give me somebody just like my daddy.
Wow.
And I literally have someone that's humble.
Yeah.
Oh my God. The way, everything I prayed for, everything I watched through my dad.
Yes.
I have it in there. So I say to God, be the glory to God.
So much for the support that you've given me over this year. Thank you for every encouraging word. Thank you for every push when it seemed like things were slowing down. I want you to know none of it went unnoticed. Thank you for those that called me during the week just to encourage me to say keep going. Thank you for these great preachers that put aside their own and push me. Thank you for those that encourage me and come and see about me. Thank you for these great leaders. Thank you for these great ushers, great deacons. For all of the people that make up this august body of believers, all I want to say is thank you for allowing us the privilege to serve. Can we give God a hand for his plan? Now, just before I turn this mic over, where's my pastor? Can we give God praise for the gift inside Pastor Byron L. Murray? No, come on, we can do better than that. Give God praise for the gift inside my pastor. I praise the name of the Lord for him and for you. And before we leave, all of my family, thank you so much. All of you that have come, taking time out of your busy schedules to share with us today. We are eternally grateful for all that God is due. I'll coin the same thing my pastor closed with. The best is still yet to come. Amen.
Let us pray. Lord, thank you for every song you sung. We say thank you. For every word you preach today, thank you. Before we ask for anything, we just say thank you for the pastor, Morris. Lady Morris, thank you for this church. We don't know what we're going to face with on next week, but we do know this, that trouble don't last always. And Lord, I ask now that you give us, take us to our homes and destinations safely. Be with us and guide us in Jesus' name. If you believe that prayer, say amen. 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 Look at your neighbor and say, I love you.